So I am Ray Umerley. I'm the Chief Information Risk Officer for Pitney Bowes. I oversee our global cybersecurity risk, privacy and data protection risk, data governance, and I also have crisis management, all of which come into play as we talk about this. The title of this presentation is a little bit misleading, because when you say how one company fought back, it sounds like we're actively, you know, adversarial. It's Apollo versus Rocky, not saying whose side of the fight I'm on. This is really more of Ralphie and Scott Fargus to some degree in A Christmas Story, which is it's a fight you don't want to enter into, but when push comes to shove, you have to do it. The intent of this, people ask me why we're talking about this. We had two ransomware attacks that I'm going to go into detail on in a 7-month period of time. I'm still employed, and actually my role now came out of this attack. I was not the Chief Information Risk Officer, I was the Chief Data Protection Officer, and then my role evolved due to some of the governance changes we made after those two attacks. But the reason to talk about it, one is to kind of embrace the narrative a bit. Everybody here at some point in time is going to be a victim of some sort of cyber attack, and we still do a really good job of blaming the victim. You must have screwed up somewhere, right? And that comes from our clients, our customers, our insurers, sometimes our own employees, our partners. And there's some truth to that, but usually when we talk about this, it's so complex and so sophisticated, it's not just a matter of like one screw up that leads to these events. It's usually a continuum of things that over time you may not have seen in the aggregate that ultimately leads to these kinds of attacks on organizations. So I'm gonna walk through, I'm gonna set the stage by talking about the attacks themselves. Then we're gonna talk about the impacts those attacks had on our organization. And keep in mind, this is not academic. This is not me pulling together stuff from a bunch of different companies and what was the aggregate trend of this and that. These are our experiences, so not all will apply, but take from that what you will. Then I'm gonna walk you through the anatomy of the attacks, because even though they were two different actors and two different extortion means, in both cases there's a lot of commonality and synergy. So I'm gonna walk you through the anatomy of the attacks, highlight protection, detection, response, and recovery considerations to take back to your organizations. A lot of this is going to factor on some of the things like all equals all, because we get, I think, a little bit overly confident sometimes about how broad our protections are and how well we're positioned for this. And then I'm going to talk about some of the learnings from the response activities, things that we took away from it, because there's a lot of really good stories to tell, but I tell a lot of people these are experiential development items I never intended to have and definitely didn't want to put on a resume. But if they're going to be there, I might as well embrace it. So, disclaimer from RSA, opinions are my own, don't represent RSA. They kind of represent Pitney Bowes to an extent, unless I say something wrong, and then they don't, so just keep that in mind. And again, take this for, everybody should take away something from this. My guess is we have probably a mix of everybody from security professionals to auditors to legal to others who have an interest in this subject. Actually, let me ask. How many people here, before I get into the rest of this, are confident that your organization is prepared for a ransomware attack? Show of hands. Wow. Okay. Few brave souls. I would have put myself in that bucket prior to October 2019. Not going to single you guys out or make you stand. How many of you have, and you guys can close your eyes for this one, how many of you have experienced a ransomware attack, either directly or indirectly? Okay. That's a good mix. So we'll probably commiserate a little bit. And happy to catch up afterwards about some joint learnings on that. And how many of you are here because you're just scared to death of ransomware and you want to figure out there's more that you could be doing? Okay, so there's some liars who didn't raise their hand for any of them, but we'll work through that. So let's talk about the attacks. October 2019, actually October 12th, I have two dates tattooed on my arms. One's in October and one's in May, and I'll talk about that in a second. On October 11th, if you would have asked me, is my organization prepared for a ransomware attack? I would have said yes, because we had all the investments in people, process, and technology. We had security operations that were running 24/7. We were talking about how many attacks we were blocking at the perimeter and how many phishing emails were stopped. And we're talking about password rotation and credentials and so forth. And we also did all the things like passed our audits, right? Internal and external auditors, they're doing everything they're supposed to be doing. We reported to the board, our risk maps were, you know, nicely color-coded and so forth. By the way, if you're interested in risk, I highly recommend listening to Alex Hutton's session from earlier today about performance-based risk. It kind of plays into this a little bit. But we looked like we had it all set. Reality was we didn't. So on October 12th of 2019, Columbus Day weekend, or Canadian Thanksgiving, or Native American Day, whatever the holiday may be, three-day weekend, 3 a.m. on a Saturday morning, I get a call from our network operations team. They start to see that servers are going offline. They don't know why. They also haven't told me at this point in time that they see them happening across multiple geographies, just that servers are going offline, we're investigating. Within the next 3 hours, by 6 a.m. that morning, we had engaged with outside forensics. We had determined that we were under an active ransomware attack. It wasn't a one and done, it was continuing. And we weren't sure how to contain it. We then spent the next 3 hours working with outside forensics to understand, okay, we need better endpoint detection response tooling. We gotta get a handle on this. We gotta start to take off different segments of our network, shut things down, literally pulling plugs in data centers to prevent the spread of the encryption payload. 9 a.m., I had the unfortunate privilege of having a call with my CEO, the entire executive management team, and the CIO and I walked through the impacts of this attack. Many of which, by the way, had been pulled off the golf course or the tennis courts or some other places on Saturday morning. They weren't really happy about that. So now I had to tell them that about 20% of our network was down. And we had significant disruption across our client base. Not a great conversation to have. We decided to do a 3-hour cadence with updates. We were engaging with law enforcement, we were engaging with regulators, we were engaging with critical partners, critical clients, all of this in the course of now probably about a 12-hour window from the time I got the call. And that continued throughout the weekend. We then decided, based on the level of disruption, the nature of the attack, and our clients were starting to notice things as well, that we were going to go public. So we worked with our communications team, and we went public with it on that Monday, on the 14th. Think about that. We went public with a massive ransomware attack, purposefully, within 48 hours. To the street, everything else. These were some of the headlines that came of that. The fortunate part was there was not a data exfiltration component to this attack. It was purely encryption, but it was heavily disruptive. And I'm gonna talk a bit about those impacts in a moment. But let's pause this. Let's assume that there was a whole lot of work that went in. Relatively happy ending. 7 months go by. May the 4th, Star Wars Day, for those of you who celebrate. I don't, I abstain, I'm a Trekkie. But so, Star Wars Day, May the 4th, 2020, security operations team calls me at 6 a.m. It's interesting how these always happen at round numbers. And they tell me, hey, we're seeing some adverse activity on the network, something malicious happening, but our EDR has stopped it. The security operations team has reacted to it. We think it was malware, we think it was encryption, we think it was a ransomware attack. A little bit of celebratory, okay, great. All the investments and so forth that we put in over the course of the last 7 months have helped us here. And then we decide, bring in the third parties, let's do the forensic activity, keep me posted. Within the next 3 hours, the narrative changed because we did stop the attack. We stopped the encryption. But what they came back to me with was, oh, by the way, we found some copy scripts within the forensics. It looked like data had been moving around from departmental file shares. These were legacy file shares that were out in different parts of the environment. Some of these were things that HR people had set up like 20 years ago and just kind of forgot and abandoned, right? And this wasn't just in the US, and as a data protection professional, I'm thinking, please God, let it just be the US, let it just be the US. No, it was Australia, it was France, it was the UK. So now we have GDPR, we have Australia, we have a whole bunch of other considerations that are going into this. As we started looking at the scripts, replicating the work, we figured out the superset of information that was taken. And then, interestingly, and we'll talk a bit about the data exfiltration component, we now found that they didn't just blow this information out to the internet, right? You would think this would alert your security operations team, what's going on, massive file transfers. No, the X copy scripts actually moved them to 3 different servers in different geographies. So they copied them locally on the internal network. And then on those servers, which were internet-facing that they had compromised, they set up a connection to a Microsoft OneDrive. Not our account, but somebody else's that they had compromised. So now, you're 2 months in, not even 2 months in, to a global pandemic when everybody is working from home, all your traffic to Microsoft Office 365 is going through the roof to the point that you're trying to figure out if you can even manage the traffic. And these guys are exfiltrating data hidden amongst all of that. Nobody saw it. Nobody saw it coming. So if you buy me a drink after this, I'll tell you the interesting story of actually engaging with Microsoft and their incident commanders, trying to find out what was actually in that OneDrive. Because I will tell you, and if there's anybody in here from Microsoft, I appreciate it, but they really want to protect their client privacy, even to the point of our detriment. Okay, so that sets the stage. Now let's talk about the impacts. Operational downtime. This was more so in Ryuk than it was in Maze. Again, we didn't have the encryption element in Maze that was blocked. Operational downtime for us with the Ryuk attack was approximately 20% of our network. Unfortunately, that included a critical component of our infrastructure. So many of you probably know Pitney Bowes as the mailing machine company, right, or the mailing meter company. That's half of our business. The other half of our business is we have approximately 70 centers across the United States that do mail sortation, fulfillment delivery returns, a lot of logistics and shipping, because we've had to evolve like many other companies have. Mailing's a declining industry. But those mailing machines are still, honestly, a cash cow for us, right? And they're still used by a lot of organizations to process and send mail, marketing mail, transactional mail, and so forth. One of the critical areas that was impacted by this was the infrastructure that underlies those mailing machines and meters that allows for the fulfillment of postage. So each one of those meters have a very robust security and encryption scheme. So if you think about it, it's an end client that communicates back to the mothership. It holds a certain amount of money on it, a certain amount of postage on it. And then when it needs more, it calls back. The infrastructure that it calls back to was now down, which now meant on a Columbus Day weekend, we had a ticking clock because those meters will continue to work until they ran out of postage. The other part was, as part of the security considerations of those systems, which are highly regulated and highly tested, it has to be by the United States Postal Service and others, we also had an arbitrary time constraint that we put in from a security purpose, because those meters needed to be able to call home to validate that they were still there, still live, the system was live. If they couldn't, they would then brick themselves, and we would have to go through a process of unlocking them. So we had two different factors here at play. One is clients who were going to be rapidly running out of postage. That had different impacts across the size of our customer base, depending on the volume. And then, of course, the ticking clock of if they can't call home, we got a completely different problem because we now have a denial of service with all of our hardware. That component of the operational downtime, to the credit of the team, we were down for approximately 5 days in the US and North America. We were down for another 4 days in our international markets in totality, because the main thing is, we'll talk about this, we had backups. But the challenge was getting those backups to actually be used, and I'll cover that in a moment. Second impact, data loss and exposure. I talked about Maze, talked about the data loss. It's amazing how little data it takes to get out of your organization before you trigger a whole bunch of other responses. Right, within 48 hours, I was on with different data protection regulators, I was on with clients, we were notifying employees who had HR data that was sent out, identity theft, credit protection, and so forth. A lot of stuff happens with just a trivial amount of information. Trivial amount of information, by the way, that once again existed in like 20-year-old file shares. But these guys were good, because when they did the scripts and they were searching beforehand for, is there confidential in the file name, human resources in the file name, so forth. I'd love to create a naming convention that basically just says we anonymize all of our file names so people don't know where that is, but we're not there yet. Customer disruption inquiry, talked about the impacts with the mailing machines and the meters. We also had in many of our operating centers and facilities, if they were on the affected network segments, the desktop machines and servers within the facilities themselves that control things like our sorters and our big equipment were encrypted. And now you have a problem because not only are they encrypted and the network's been pulled because we pulled all the plugs, how do you restore those when you don't have access to the images to actually bring them back online? We literally had business people, sales executives, and others hopping on planes and sneaker netting USB drives and other images to those sites to get them up and running again. But again, customer disruption was significant, but the inquiry piece was even more so. So we chose to go public on Monday. How many calls do you think I had to take with clients in that week? Any show of hands, less than 50. Show of hands, less than 100. Show of hands, less than 200. Okay, about 168 calls. Now, this is the interesting thing, and I, as a client of service providers, I would do the same thing. They wanted to talk to the senior most person in the company. Well, guess what the senior most person in the company was doing at that time, right? So now we're having to pull me off different things, pull other people. We literally created a task force of people, and I was like, I don't care what they say, lie. Tell them you're me, here's your script, talk to them. It sounds horrible, but it's true, because we could only give them the fact patterns anyway, right? And then we also were inundated by those who didn't want to have a call, they wanted a questionnaire completed. And some of those questionnaires were online. Some of them were 25-page Excel sheets, and they needed it in 48 hours, and they were going to turn us off. And so now I have a different denial of service attack looming with many of these clients, but that's part of the customer disruption inquiry. Workforce stress, if you haven't figured out, we were pretty stressed at this point. But we literally, there's a lot of really great stories, and one day I'll do a session where we talk about the great stories that come out of these events around grit and resiliency and ingenuity of our workforce. But this was 24/7 hand-to-hand combat, multiple war rooms set up, particularly for Ryuk, a little less so for Maze because we didn't have the disruption. But we had people that refused to leave, and even if they couldn't help with the recovery efforts or the containment or the forensics, they would stay to clean up the pizza boxes or sweep the floors because they didn't want to go home. Legal regulatory obligations, all of you are familiar with what could happen there. I'm not going to wax on. There's a ton of sessions here. We'll talk to you about those and what you should and should not do. Financial loss. Financial loss of these attacks, and I'm only going to talk about the stuff that's actually reported within our 10K, so again, public information. But financial loss for these attacks, we typically measure in both direct and indirect costs. You've all seen the Ponemon studies. You all know the average cost of a data breach. But the bottom line hit on this for Ryuk, for full-year revenue in 2019, was a $18 million hit to full-year revenue, which translates to 8 cents earnings per share. That's a significant hit to your bottom line, especially for a company that's transforming. And if you've checked our stock price, it hasn't been going exactly the way we want it to go. That's a significant hit. And then, of course, brand and reputation. Nobody walks out of this unscathed. But the brand and reputational component isn't lost just on your clients. We had partners who were questioning whether or not they should stay connected to us. We had employees questioning, did we do the right things, and creating their own narratives because of different islands of understanding. And then, of course, regulators and AGs. Months after Ryuk was closed, we had satisfied everything. I was still getting inquiries from random attorney general's offices in different states. Why? Not because the attack was fresh, but because I had a Pitney Bowes meter in the office, and somebody told them about the attack, and they wondered why they didn't hear about it. And the reality was, is because their data wasn't impacted. They weren't breached. Nothing happened. But we still had to respond. By the way, I love any AGs in the audience. I'm just calling them out of spade there. So let's talk about the anatomy of the attacks. First and foremost, both attacks we know came in through phishing. In the first instance, it came in through phishing of one of our employees. We think the dwell time probably was in a matter of weeks as opposed to days. And in the second instance, we're pretty confident that Patient Zero was actually a third-party managed service provider. So they didn't come in through our email system, they came in through theirs, and then leveraged their credentials and their access to our network to start the Maze attack. Important learnings here, so some things to think about is, one, think about your automated systems here, what you're looking at in terms of scanning emails, scanning attachments, scanning for hyperlinks, quarantining, and so forth. All the stuff that I'm sure there will be a ton of vendors that will tell you that they can do it. But take it serious. Think about that. Think about how it's configured. Training and awareness. We were doing quarterly phishing exercises. We moved to monthly phishing exercises. We were looking at click rates, felt pretty comfortable with it. But the reality is what we were doing was the out-of-the-box, probably the simplest kind of phishing attacks. Now we've gotten really serious. If you want to get interesting click rates, send a phishing email, a carefully crafted phishing email to your legal team that says urgent subpoena, reply necessary, and see how many clicks you get. So start thinking about crafting those to the audiences, because the reality is this is still the first and foremost vector that these attacks are coming in on. And as we think about the hybrid work model that many of us are in, except for Tesla, apologies to Tesla, but if we think about that model, it becomes even more complex because now we're trying to balance, right, between work and personal, people's Gmail accounts and Yahoo accounts, and God knows somebody probably still uses Hotmail. But those accounts, too, don't go through the same levels of protections. But if you're allowing that access on your corporate assets, the malware can impact it just the same. So think about how that works and whether or not you want to take a hard approach with a hammer, maybe a more surgical approach with a different tool, but you have to get a control of the email. Of course, once that happens, we get our Trojan malware installed, and you guys have all heard of TrickBot and Emotet and Mimikatz and those kind of things, and we saw all of those. But making sure that your AV or your endpoint detection response or whatever the cool name is for it, I think it's XDR, right? Is that what it is now? XDR. So make sure it's configured to detect and block these things, but also make sure it's behavioral-based and not just signature-based. Because if you flip a bit in some of these things, it's going to slide right through, and that's actually what we saw with our TrickBot installation in Ryuk. And also importantly is your security operations teams that are monitoring these. Make sure they understand the concept of context. Because a TrickBot or Emotet installation on a workstation is a lot different than on a server, and a lot different than if it's on an Active Directory domain controller. So just seeing the alert and seeing that the software did something to remediate it is not enough. You need to do deeper exploration, understand what was it on, what happened, and how did it get there. That leads to credential theft. We'll talk about multi-factor in a second, but so the credential theft here, think about it, it's not just about the credentials of the person who's using the machine. Things like Mimikatz will go into the cache credentials of those different machines, so anybody who's logged in. Desktop administrator, a server administrator, somebody who used credentials that they shouldn't to just do a quick administrative task. If you haven't configured your group policy in Windows appropriately, those credentials will still be there. Mimikatz will find them, and it will send them to the bad guys, and they will use those. So really think hard and fast about how your credentials are preserved, how long tokens exist, and so forth in your different applications and in your operating systems. Multi-factor will prevent some of this, but again, I'm trying to get to, let's not have something that needs to prevent. Lateral movement and network. We'll talk a lot about network segmentation. The reality is, and I'm sure a lot of you out here have the same problem, we're a 102-year-old company, and I'm pretty sure some of our networks are that old too. They're extremely flat, right? And when you have a really flat physical network, it's really hard to segment that. And there's some software-defined tools, and but there's a disruption component to it, and how do you segment it, where do you segment it? We've done a lot of that in the last, 36 months or whatever. I had a lot less gray hair when we started. But think about that lateral movement. Where do those credentials allow you to go, and what can you do to minimize the blast radius when you can? And there's different solutions for that, but this is important, because the reality is at some point in time, somebody will get in, and the best thing you can do is put up more and more blocks so they can't get very far. Once they were in, of course, recon Active Directory. Sorry, AV guy, didn't mean to hit the mic. It's amazing how much information Microsoft's Active Directory will give up to an authenticated user on a network. It's just unreal. When I first learned about how much just a general query will give you about organizational units and groups and administrator names and so forth, there's not a lot you can do to prevent that per se. There's some policy changes you can make, but that gives these actors a roadmap to who they can now start to target for the important part, which is elevation of privileges, right? So if you can query Active Directory and you can get the different organizational groups and you know who's in IT and maybe who's in the security administrators group or what are your backup service accounts that have access to like everything, you can start to create a roadmap of who do I need to target and who do I need to get to and how do I get there. And so once we get to that elevation of privileges, privilege access management is important. And I'm using a lot of buzzwords, but I'm not using the acronyms because my boss is actually the general counsel and he hates acronyms, so I have to put a dollar in a jar every time I use them. But privilege access management is important. And that comes down to not having people who are using their exact same user credential for all their administrative access, to creating specific administrative accounts that are heavily monitored, making sure your service accounts are non-interactive. Amazing how many interactive service accounts you have, and you have security scanning, vulnerability management, backups, and so forth, and a whole bunch of accounts that have way too much privilege that anybody could just log into and use. Then for Maze, we didn't have this for Ryuk, we had the exfiltration of data. Data is hard. I've been battling this with our company for quite a while now since Maze, and we're making progress. I'm still not where I want to be. But when you're dealing with unstructured data and structured data, and unstructured being the documents, the PDFs, the JPEGs, the music files, all the things that marketing thinks is really valuable, apologies, marketing. And then you also have your structured data applications, your critical business applications, and so forth. I would argue structured data is a lot easier, right? Because you kind of secure the location to some degree. You can put MFA around it. You can do encryption in mass and so forth. Unstructured is really, really tough. Because the reality is those are the documents that everybody's producing. It's the data exhaust that everybody's producing on a day-to-day. It has to be collaborative. It has to be shareable outside of the world, those kind of things. So just saying, let's encrypt it all. That'll only solve it for one location, like internally. As soon as you start to send that out, try sending it. We have 1.5 million customers, a lot of sole props, a lot of doctor's offices. The more complex you make it to access the data, the less likely they're going to continue to be your client. So it's a really tough problem to solve. But so think about how you're protecting that information, narrow it down to your critical data assets, but also think about how can you detect when it leaves. And that could be classification, it could be labeling, it could just, again, be these are our most critical repositories. We're going to put a lot of monitoring on that, see what comes out of it, make sure it doesn't go very far. Next stage was around deleting backups, disabling security protections. These were all about trying to make recovery impossible and therefore increasing the likelihood you'll pay, and disabling security protections so they could launch the payloads and not be detected or prevented more likely. Our backups in the case of Ryuk were all preserved because fortunately the attack was very Windows-based, and our backups were actually stored on a Unix-based appliance. So that was the only preservation of the backups. But the one thing I will note, and we'll talk about this with the scale of digital disaster recovery, even though you have the backups, doesn't mean you can restore them. Because what happens when the backup application servers that are running on Windows are now encrypted? And now you have to rebuild those and re-index your backups. Oh, and oh, by the way, there was corruption in your Active Directory, so now you gotta rebuild your Active Directory before you can get to the back. You see where I'm going with this. There's a lot of things that happen in these events where it's like, we've got good backups. That's not enough. And then, of course, deploying the payload. And again, the best preventative measure here is hopefully stopping them somewhere along the way before they get to that point. But once you're there, making sure you have good endpoint detection response, good security operations, adhering to the 1-10-60 kind of mantra, you know, 1 minute to detect, 10 minutes to investigate, 60 minutes to remediate. You know, that's the last clear moment of being able to prevent this. Okay, that's a lot. Let me take a deep breath. I'm doing pretty good on time, right? Okay. So let's talk about some of the lessons on response and recovery. And again, these are our lessons unique to Pitney Bowes. I think they can be shared with other organizations as well. So positive, speed of response. Organization, like I said, 3 a.m., 6 a.m., 9 a.m., we had all the executives on. Maze was a similar way in just in terms of we had, in terms of how we reacted from an incident response. Very pleased with all that. The biggest challenge was as fast as we wanted to respond because of some of the technical challenges we couldn't. But our crisis management framework that we already had in place, our incident response processes which we already had in place, contributed to a successful response. Third-party security expertise, having good partners, whether that's third-party forensics, insurers, outside counsel, IT suppliers, if you need new hardware, because the reality is when you start encrypting servers, take them offline, you want to go to rebuild them, if they're end of life, it's a little hard sometimes to do that. So how do you get that equipment replaced quickly? And then also, there are companies out there, and I will tout the benefits of one, but I'm not supposed to promote anybody here, so I won't say it. But you know, that do ransomware negotiation. They understand the MOs of the actors. They understand how to negotiate with them. Both of our ransom, by the way, I will not disclose payment terms or if we paid or did not pay. That gets into a sticky wicket. My general counsel gets really nervous because no good answer comes out of that. Yes, no, neither one's good. But what I will say is in both cases, they were eight-figure amounts, initial demands, eight figures. We're not talking $65,000. And of course, eight figures in Bitcoin. So the other thing is, think about it. If you were going to pay, how many of you have eight figures in Bitcoin in your company? Right? So that's where third-party expertise comes in, because many of those negotiators will also have ways to get fundage if you needed it. Our state of our backups, I talked about that. Those were preserved, but again, the challenges of getting them up and running again with the application servers. Our overall business operations resilience. We have, because we need to, robust business continuity and DR plans, but they're heavily focused on weather-related events. You know, civil unrest, zip code lane closures, all these other things that are very physical in nature because they always rely on, I can go from point A to point B and I'd still be okay. I might limp along. But what happens when point A to Z and all the connectivity in between is now suspect? Can you recover from that? So as you think about your business operations, there has to be some planning for these cyber events. And I'll mention that on a later slide, but that's the critical component here as we get into concepts of scale and where we take advantage of shared architecture that may not be available for those recoveries. Communications were strong. Again, this was part of our crisis management framework. If you haven't been able to tell, I do have media training, so that helped. We worked with our communications team early to craft the message. Once those other things with the 168 calls got too much, I ended up doing a webinar. I became a face of a breach. I never wanted to be a face of a breach or the voice of one. But it helped because it alleviated the teams, it gave our clients comfort, we were being transparent and so forth. But communications are key, not only to your clients, not only to your regulators, but also your employees. Because in the absence of knowing what the story is, they will make up their own. And this is a disruptive event across the organization, so don't forget those in the process. And then enterprise teaming and ingenuity. One of the best stories that I had was towards the end of Ryu, probably one of the closest moments where I was really questioning what we were going to do. We couldn't locate backups in one of the current backups in one of the countries that we operate. It wasn't a significant market. It wasn't a lot of money. But we wanted to do the right thing the right way for that client. We fortunately found in a closet, somebody found a backup tape in a closet, and the engineers were able to rebuild the transaction history to get that back up to the point in time. And they did a lot of creative ways to do that, pulling funds from different meters, understanding transaction logs, and so forth. But it was one of those literal moments where everybody came together with a focused purpose and achieved the goal, and it was huge. We got the client back online, but it was scary. Negatives, ensuring that all equals all. If I don't cover any other bullet on that, that's important. How many of you sit in meetings where we talk about 99% endpoint detection response across all of our endpoints? And how many things that we blocked at the firewalls? And all these other things that we did the same thing. But the reality is a lot of those metrics are based on known endpoints, known ingress, known egress. And as our perimeters continue to expand, how much of that is actually known? How many of you are confident that your asset inventories and your architectural maps actually reflect the current state of your network? So making sure all equals all is important because that's how these actors will get in, but also when you're recovering, that gives you your roadmap of how you recover. Speed and scale recovery, again, I talked about that from a DR perspective. Digital disaster recovery is very, very different than your traditional BCP and DR. Islands of understanding, this one's a unique one because during any critical crisis event, and I even led crisis management for a COVID response in the first 8 weeks of the pandemic, that was fun. Any event, there's islands of understanding in an organization about what is it, how does it work, how do we fix it, what do we do, and also about how we should respond. In the first 4 or 5 hours of the Raik attack, I actually had to talk a senior leader off of the cliff of, he was like, I think I'm going to message these guys and see what they want. I'm like, no. We're gonna get professionals who do that. We've never done this before. But everybody has a different perspective. So making sure that you have singular people to lead, aggregate information, distribute information, keep everybody on the same page is vitally important. This can't just be IT's running a piece of it, InfoSec's running a piece of it, business continuity's running a piece of it. It has to be a concerted effort because those islands can be really damaging, not only to your recovery efforts, but to your brand. IT tools immobilized, we talked about if backup application servers go down, your security tools go down, your Active Directory goes down. A lot of impacts there. And these are all things that will be targeted by a ransomware attacker, because that's gonna maximize the opportunity for them to actually get profit. Individual and teams overwhelmed, this goes back to the workforce stress. Everybody was overwhelmed. And then partners. So we had a lot of really great partners. We also had some partners that weren't so great. I had several partners that I had to get on calls with because they were threatening to turn off parts of their services to us. And I had to assuage their concerns that no, it's not moving laterally, we've contained it and so forth, because they were gonna create another denial of service for me on different parts of our organization while we're already trying to recover different places. But everybody gets overwhelmed in this. It's a very stressful moment. And your partners and your clients' concerns aren't just about whether or not your products and services are still working or whether or not you're still utilizing their software or whatever it is. They're concerned about their own networks, their own brand. So I don't blame them for being that way. I'm still hold a little bit of angst about it, but you know, I don't blame them for it. But that's the reality of the situation. So, apply what you've learned today. What happened? My slides didn't show up. Oh, there it went. I went too fast. Apologies, guys. I'm only a technologist on Twitter. I think if I go back, it popped up. Yes, okay. So, RSA asked me in the template, oh, do this like week, 3 months, 6 months. The reality is, depending on organizations, this will be very different in timing. There is no set formula for this. But how I would apply the things that I talked about today is evaluate your own capabilities in context of this discussion. I know I dropped a lot of information on you. This is gonna be, I think it's recorded, you can replay it, so forth. Share it with your teams. But start thinking about where are the holes in our defenses? What are the assumptions that we're making? And maybe start to rethink some of that calculus. Identify your infrastructure crown jewels. I would argue this is both infrastructure crown jewels, your critical applications, and your critical data. Where does it exist? At least at a high level. Where does it exist? What are they? How do we prioritize it? And then start looking at the blocking and tackling. We love to say that these are sophisticated persistent attacks, and they absolutely are. But sometimes saying something is sophisticated just means that they were a little bit better, a little bit smarter, a little bit faster than we were, right? And we couch it as sophisticated, and it makes us feel better. But the reality is a lot of these things, multi-factor authentication, privilege access management, group policies, like all the stuff that I shared, these are not expensive propositions for some companies. Evaluate it, and again, make sure where you have it, it does all equals all. In the first 3 months, now we're getting a little bit more complex. Ensure that you have an accurate asset inventory. I laughed when I wrote that down, because if you do that in 3 months, I'm impressed. The reality is that's an ever, that will be a problem that will plague you forever and ever and ever, but you can at least try to move the needle and get closer and closer to reality. And again, that goes back to think about not just what's in your internal infrastructure, but all those different connection points, your cloud-based services, your managed service providers, your employees connecting from remote and so forth. Scenario-based tabletops. We talk about tabletop exercises a lot. Red teams, blue teams, purple teams, orange teams, yellow teams. I know, I made up those last two, don't look those up. But when we think about these exercises, do them in a focused way. Don't just sit people in a room and say, we've had a ransomware attack, what do we do and how do we respond? Do a, we've had a ransomware attack and Active Directory's been compromised. Our backup application servers are down. Our data has been exfiltrated. A small amount of data, how would we identify that data? And how would we determine what's in that data set to make a risk calculation about whether or not we should even engage with these guys? Those are the kind of scenarios you have to run through. Use MITRE, use other things, use real threat modeling techniques when you run these tabletops to evaluate your potential. And of course, updating your business continuity. If you do not have a cyber disruption, cyber event in your business continuity plan, you're already behind the pace. You have to have one. It has to be part of your consideration. Within 6 months, again, these are idealistic and optimistic. So for those of you shaking your heads about timelines, I know they're not realistic. Look holistically at people, process, and technology. Failure points will happen across all three. And a lot of them are well-meaning and well-intentioned. I'll give you a good example of the technology piece for privileged access management. In one of the attacks, we had privileged access management. We had a leading provider of privileged access management. Our credentials were vaulted in that leading provider. We thought the server configuration was set appropriately. They'd validated the configuration. We'd validated the configuration. There were actually vulnerabilities in the configuration of the server itself that allowed the bad actors to get onto the server, wait for somebody to ask for credentials, pull them from the memory of the server. This is your vaulting technology. And we rebuilt it, and we've corrected those things. But again, there's assumptions that we set these tools up and they're going to protect us, but the configuration is critical. And then I will go back to the context piece with the security operations. It's not enough to say, we saw it and the software did something about it. You have to go through and analyze what those events were. Where did they take place? Where did they come in from? Were they on an Active Directory domain controller? Were they on a backup server? And really apply context to those events, not just signal to noise. Crisis plans, you gotta have crisis plans for these things. These are organization-wide events. They're not just PCPDR. It's not just an IT event. It is a company-changing, altering event. And there are a lot of touch points outside of the organization, whether it's external media, PR, crisis communications companies, insurers. By the way, engage your insurers early in this process. If you have cyber insurance and you don't engage your insurers as soon as this starts, good luck getting them to pay for anything. And then identify and establish relationships or retainers. Get to know who these people are. Get to know who your third-party forensic providers are. Get to know who the third-party brokers are, the negotiators, and so forth. Understand outside counsel. Everybody has different capacities, different budgets. But prioritize and think about, is there a firm that I should have at the ready so you don't have to try to hunt it down, or God forbid, go looking for Yelp reviews to determine who you should call in a matter of crisis. And that's the end of that, so I think I have time for questions. Okay, 10 minutes? Okay, so we have 10 minutes for Q&A.
Obviously, you had a major financial impact. What was the percentage? What was your financial impact as a percentage of revenue again?
So the overall for the 2019 year, it was $18 million. Now, in a given year, we're about $3 to $4 billion company. It doesn't seem significant, but
A statement prior to last couple of years, I was working internal audit or CPA firms, and I banged my head against the walls because. I'm sorry, any CPAs in this room, but I would argue until I was blue in the face that incident response and disaster recovery were financial risk. They said, oh no, that has nothing to do with the financial statement. We don't care about that for SOX audits. And what did your internal audit department say to you after this about what they are going to do differently in their Sarbanes-Oxley or SOC audits? And the reason why I want to know this is because there's a lot of people out there who thinks that that's just an IT issue. It's not a corporate risk issue.
Right. So there's a couple things that helped us with this, and I'll talk about audit. So we actually treat cybersecurity as an enterprise-level risk. I actually own that for the enterprise. We have 13 enterprise risks, including things like liquidity, people in society, supply chain. Cybersecurity and privacy and data are two enterprise risks. I get the pleasure of speaking to the board once a quarter and the audit committee twice a year on that topic. So the general auditor was already aware that this was a significant consideration for the organization. Coming out of this, what we've done is we've aligned a lot of his audits. We've shifted from things like SOCs and SOC 2 and those kind of things, and also focused on, in general, our cybersecurity risk factors. Because I actually tore up our cybersecurity risk at the end of this process and reconstituted it. And I pulled directly from the MITRE ATT&CK framework. And my sub-risk number one was ransomware, malware, and hacking. That was my number one risk. And I had our mitigation plan, our had our heat map, and I worked with the general auditor to basically say, okay, if you're going to audit cybersecurity, let's think about, one, how do we chunk it up sensibly, right? Because I always love when I get a cybersecurity audit. There's so many facets of that. You're not going to capture it in one audit, right? But how do we chunk that up and then also tie that back to our mitigation program to make sure we're actually doing what we're doing? And that includes incident response. And he was very open to that, and he's done that with his groups. We've also used things like the Center for Internet Security Controls to help augment that control set. But we shifted a lot from just compliance-based frameworks. And thank you all for coming, by the way. So we shifted from compliance-based frameworks into more risk mitigation frameworks, NIST, CSF, CIS, and so forth. And that's been a significant shift for us in terms of our readiness. Other questions? Yes.
This is great. Learned a lot from today's session. I want to know what is your recommendation or advice to do the top five things when someone is under ransomware attack? Just like they found out that, you know, some people have been saying, should we just disconnect all our, computers, or should we start buying new stuff and do everything from the scratch? Like, wanted to understand the top five things and overall, what's your suggestion?
So great question. The question was top five things to do in a ransomware attack. I'm going to answer part of it, then I'm going to wuss out a little bit. Getting to top five is going to be really organizational dependent. The first and foremost thing I would say is don't panic. And I say that as somebody who's done these things, done the incident response, done the crisis. The worst thing you can do is panic because you're going to exacerbate the situation. So try to get the right people in charge of the incident handling process. A lot of times that's not going to be your SOC manager. It needs to be somebody a little bit higher up the chain who can see more holistically beyond IT and information security. The second thing is then focus heavily on containment. But while you're focusing on containment and stopping the attack from happening, make sure that you're also preserving to the extent that you can the forensics. Because one of the worst things that happens in some of these attacks is you focus so heavily on starting to pull plugs and rebuilding servers, you lose vital evidence to tell you just how impactful it was. And that was a case in Maze. We took a lot of servers offline. The IT teams wanted to get them back online. They rebuilt them. I then had to ask for like backups, trying to find just this moment in time where there was still resident data to figure out what got out of the organization. So when you focus on containment, don't lose the forensics. And then the third piece is, again, think about this as, this is a little bit of a war of attrition, but it's about resiliency, okay? So when these things happen, you can go through all those things to recover from the attack, but make sure you have business processes that at least can be up and running, limping along, sustainable, whatever, as you're moving through the organization. Because the reality is these things are disruptive, as I discussed, but what I didn't discuss is you're pulling people off of active product development, revenue generation opportunities, sales cycles, marketing. This is an organization-wide event when these things happen, and they're gonna be disrupted in some way. So think about how that resiliency planning comes in. That's the three things I would offer. I wish I could get to five. I could, but the last two are gonna be highly debatable. Yes, and if you could come up to the mics, I'd appreciate it, just so we can make sure we capture it appropriately.
So one quick question for you.
Yes.
Not all the company, but some of the company has a trade secret, which is not legally protected. Once you know a ransomware attack is successful, is there any recommendation, advice, how we can recover it?
So if I understood the question correctly, this is about trade secret IP protections and so forth in a ransomware attack, compromising that? Is that kind of the question, or I just want to make sure I captured it appropriately. I missed the last part of it a little bit. There's the mask.
So, IP is registered, so legally protected it.
Yes.
Right? So somebody actually maliciously using it, we can start caught. However, trade secret is not open for public. Mm-hmm. But those information, start stealing it and being used. so legally cannot protect it.
Right.
So ransomware, you know, attack is successful, but you know, they promised, oh, we're not using it, but how we can trust these hackers?
Well, that's the thing. There, and I've got the question now. So the question really comes down to how do you trust the hackers, especially as you think about the negotiations. The interesting perspective on this with the FBI and so forth, so it was funny too, because the FBI for Ryuk, it was a special agent in Alaska. I'm pretty sure it's because he saw Russia from his house. And then there was another one in Los Angeles for Mays. But in all those instances, and even with the outside professionals, they were like, well, there's an honor amongst thieves, right? So this is their business model. So they basically say, we're not going to tell you to pay, but we recognize there's a business consideration if you do. I think at some point in time in the last couple of years, that might have held true, and we kind of saw it with Mays, we saw it with some other actors, and again, I'm not talking about our particular situation, but knowing that other companies who went through that cycle, if they did something, they got some assurance that the data was given back to them, or laughably, they get a security assessment, because that's what technically you paid for. You didn't pay to get your data back, you got a security assessment, which is usually like three bullets that just say, we broke into your system, and you know, here's the basic blocking and tackling you didn't do. But I think in the last couple of years, it's morphed. I don't think there is any trust anymore in this because there's so many different agents and actors involved in these processes that even if you think you've resolved it with one, they probably sold your credentials, sold your data, sold something else to other people that will now take advantage of it, even if it's not that one group. And I say that because when you go through these discussions and when you're thinking about the ransomware, there's a number of things in the risk calculus that go well beyond can we recover, right? It's what do you get back? What assurances do you have? And one of the things, like with Mays, the more things we did going public with the attack, engaging with data protection authorities, notifying infected employees, it diminished the value of that data to us because the brand reputational hit was already there. The regulatory hit was already there. So as you, the more things you do in the proper response, the less valuable it becomes to you, which means it's less value for the hacker, and it's easier to kind of move on. Does that help? Next question.
So during ransomware incident, ongoing crisis, how did you handle communications with regards to your ELT, your leaders, and all that? You know, it's raining baseballs, right? So
right.
How do you handle that? And what kind of reporting mechanisms did you use? The second part of the question is, did you set up any out-of-band comms when you know the actor is in your network?
Yeah, so I'm going to answer the second question first because it's easier. So did we set up any out-of-band comms during the attacks? The answer is yes, because at the time we weren't sure what was compromised, what wasn't compromised. So we did use things like Google and Slack and other things that we were fairly confident weren't our Office 365, and also cell phones. Cell phones are great. And my boss, the general counsel, loves phones because conversations are a lot harder to capture in a deposition or discovery later. In terms of managing the communication, so there's a couple different pieces. The internal communications piece is important, especially with your executive leadership team. One of the things I've done a really good job of cultivating with my leadership team is trust. So as we go into this, it's like I'm going to establish a set of facts. We can have the open discussion, but the decisions or the actions as it relates to the incident are mine, and then ultimately the CEO's. So you have to do that, because otherwise you're going to get a whole bunch of business leaders saying that their business is the most appropriate. We need to do this. We need to do that. So you have to establish the hierarchy of who are the decision makers and the authority in the room. And that was very, very helpful as we went through that. We set up a cycle of every 3-hour updates. That continued for multiple days, and we would only bring forward the facts. That's the other piece. There's a lot of assumptions. There's a lot of working theory. There's a lot of superstition that comes up in these attacks. You gotta stick to the fact patterns, because they will change, they will augment. And if you're basing your decisions and your risk calculus on those facts, make sure that they're verified and they've had a little bit of time to age before you react to it. And then from the external perspective, a lot of people talk about playbooks. You should absolutely have crisis communications playbooks and frameworks. The one thing I'm not an advocate of is huge textbooks with fixed documentation that you pull off the shelf, because you're going to have to create it on the fly. So just have a set of principles that you know you're going to follow and acknowledge about how you're going to be transparent, who you're going to engage, and who needs to approve those communications, because everything else is going to go out the window when you hit these events.
You mentioned the attack vectors were through phishing. Were they exactly the same for both attacks within 6 months, or did they diverge and be able to help?
They were different, because in the first one, again, it was phishing against our employee base, and the way we were able to verify this is we actually went with our third-party friends, and they were showing us where campaigns were launched by different actors, and these were broad campaigns across multiple companies. So they're trying to hit as many organizations as they can at once. So we were actually able to correlate those attacks to an active campaign that had been run by the Ryuk actors. It was actually Grim Spider was the specific adversarial group at the time, and identify that. Now, with that said, it was the actual attachment and so forth as part of that campaign was kind of lost to us. We didn't get that piece of it because of some of the retention history and so forth, but we were able to get to that. The second attack wasn't us, it was a third party. And the challenge with that third party managed service provider is they acknowledged what happened, but we didn't have the forensic detail and all the other things to kind of tie it back. I mean, we knew it was Maze based on the event, but they went in through the third party who had the necessary access to our systems and then piggyback that to the rest. So. I think this is probably our last one.
Just real quick, on how do you vet the middleman who negotiates with the bad guys? Like, how do you know he's not a bad guy?
So this is where you go with known, there is one known firm. I will happily give you the name after the session because I don't want to violate any of the RSA rules. That's out there. But there are some that have built a business on this. They built a reputation on this. Do not go with somebody who just says, I know how to do this. They have to have references. And ours were actually, just so you guys know, and this is why it's important to engage with your risk management teams during this and your insurers, ours came from our insurer. So our insurer was like, listen, our clients use this guy. Go to him. And the benefit of that is twofold. One, now you've got validation, right? Because he's obviously got a pretty good Yelp score if he's being referred by the insurers. But the other part is now he's pre-approved. And when you go through these exercises with your insurers and you did not use somebody who was pre-approved on that list, they might work with you, but they probably will not. So again, use your insurers as a resource to help identify these parties. So we are out of time. Thank you all for this session. Thank you for coming. Appreciate it.